Hello friends. Happy Monday. I hope everyone had a pleasant weekend. Let's start our week off right by hacking a few dungeons. So I thought I would answer a few questions that I've received over the course of the LP so far. One commenter wondered why I made my character chaotic good, and I realized that I really should have shown off the choose characters screen, because I don't think I ever did that either in this LP or the previous one. So this is a list of pre-generated characters you can choose from. There are a bunch of different options, and they went through the effort of making a little backstory for each one, which I thought was pretty cool. This is a 127-year-old elf magic user, Cathra Shallowtaint. No comment. My character, Duke of the Bump, is based on this fellow by the name of... Wow, there are a lot of these guys. By the name of... Metwell Greenwood. And I chose this guy because he was the only non-multi-class cleric available. And his backstory is that... Well, you can pause and read it if you want. I'm not going to read this whole thing because none of this stuff matters. But it's a nice little touch that they actually wrote out a paragraph of text for everyone. I made my character Duke of the Bump chaotic good because Metwell Greenwood is chaotic good. So that's the only reason. And I based all of my stats on Metwell's stats. And although Metwell was 18, you can't affect that. You can't manually set your age. So... Duke of the Bomb started out as level 17. So that's why, just in case anyone was wondering. Anyway, let's get on with it. Let's continue our game. And we are on level 8. Soundtrack, once again, Etrian Odyssey 4. Really awesome game. I've had a chance to play it a good bit over the weekend, and I'm really enjoying it. Someone else wondered what the yellow thing that goes across the screen from time to time is. And there's a yellow and a red thing now. And in case anyone else didn't realize, those are the Ion Stones, or however that's pronounced. I have my Ion Stone of Petrification Protection, and this one that is still unidentified. And I looked it up on the D&D wiki, and there's really no explanation, at least on the wiki, for what these things actually are or why they have magical powers. But they circle around the user's head at a distance of 1 to 3 feet, and you roll randomly to determine how many feet it circles around your head. And if it's further than 3 feet from you, then it has no effect. So it has to be in that radius. Do I need to rest? Yeah, I should probably go ahead and rest. Let's change up my spells. I determined that the invisible to undead lasting forever is actually a glitch, because I went back and I just started a new game with a level 1 cleric just to test, and I got invisible to undead right off the bat. And with that character, as soon as I swung my mace, I didn't even have to attack a monster with it, I just swung my mace through the air, the spell dissipated, it was no longer in effect. And I tried giving this character a mace to see if, well, maybe the hammer just doesn't count as a weapon for some reason. That would be pretty broken if that was the case. But even with my mace, I still have the invisible undead. So it is definitely a glitch, and I don't know how long it's going to last. It might last until the end of this LP. But, you know, I'm going to take advantage of it because I didn't put in a cheat code. I didn't look up a way to cause this glitch to happen. It just happened naturally. So, you know, you gotta play the hand you're dealt. So I'm gonna go ahead and not bother with invisible and undead unless the glitch wears off and the spell actually wears off. I'm gonna keep Cure Light Wounds and Protection from Evil. I'll get a Detect Magic just for laughs. See if there's anything I have that might be worth a closer look. I'm going to stick with my Spiritual Hammers and Aids for level 2. This combo seems to be working out very well for me. I don't have any rations, do I? Oh, I can't check that here. Hold on. have to get out of... Okay, I do have rations, so no need to create food and water just yet. So I will keep... Well, I don't know what enemies I'll encounter here, so negative plane protection might be necessary, it might not. But I'll take two of each for now. And Cure Serious seems like a pretty good one to hold on to. If there's anything that paralyzes or holds me, I'll get free action. Flame Strike, I'll hang on to it, even though it doesn't seem to have done much so far. Hopefully I'll have better luck with the enemies on this level. Oh wait, I have two of these now, I forgot. I'll take a Flame Strike and a Cure Critical then. Okay, awesome. Another comment, well actually a couple commenters were wondering, they actually noticed something that I didn't. In my character sheet, it says I am age 21, despite starting the game at age 17. And I have absolutely no idea why that happened. I mean, it definitely hasn't been 4 years in the course of this game. I mean, I've rested a few times, but the total number of hours I've rested isn't more than a few days. So, I have no idea what's going on. It could be, like, the level drain attack has some sort of unforeseen consequence of unnaturally aging whoever's hit by it. Or there might be, like, it might be the experience book I read. Like, it gave me a point of charisma, and it reflected the additional experience I have by aging my character. I have no idea. And one commenter pointed out, I'm not sure if this is in Dungeon Hack specifically or just D&D, but they pointed out that characters over age 60 take some sort of stat penalty. Which I think, oh god, what the fudge is that? It's a cobra with a skull that fires magic missiles. A human looking skull. Okay. What in God's name? Bone Naga. Okay. Well, that makes sense. Well, it didn't seem to be that hard to deal with. I wonder if it counts as undead. I don't know. Oh. Right off the bat, we had to go searching for a secret door. So yeah, after... Oh, another new enemy. Looks like a... I never know how to pronounce this word. A chimera? A chimera? One of those mythological beasts. Where the heck... Oh! Says I've killed 5 of those. Wait, that can't be right. That was the first one I've killed, right? That was the first one I've seen in this LP. Weird. Oops. Oh, I have 65 hit points total, in case anyone was wondering. After a certain level, I think it's level 6 or 7, you only start getting 2 hit points with every level you go up. Whereas before that, it was 1d8. So from this point on, every time we go up a level, it will only add 2 hit points to our total. Say, maybe the chimera counts as multiple creatures because of the multiple heads that it has. But even then, it should only be 3, right? Oh, wow, that hurt. The lion, the dragon, and the wolf. Not sure where the other 2 come in. I guess we can't see the other side of the chimera, so... There could be some stuff... See, that one counted as 2. Weird. Huh. Okay, so this one shoots a fire projectile, which looks to be dodgeable. How many... I won't do this every time, I'm just curious. Okay, that one only counted as 1. That's very odd. So it's similar to the ghost on the previous level that fired the projectile, and I could actually move around quickly and dodge it. Or it's easier to dodge than the melee attacks. It's kind of like how in Doom, the first enemies you encounter, the zombie men and the shotgun guys, their attack is like a hit scan. So if you're in their line of sight, it just automatically hits you. And that's kind of how the melee attacks in this game are. And then the projectiles are like the fireballs that the imps in Doom throw. So you can actually sidestep them. Which makes, even though the imps look scarier, and you encounter them after the zombie men, they're actually not as big of a threat, unless you get up close. Where did that take me? So, let's see, any other questions that people had? I think that about covers it. If anyone has any other questions as to how I'm playing the game or why I'm doing certain things, make sure you let me know. I realize that I move kind of fast in this game, and some of it might be kind of hard to follow. So, if there's anything I'm not explaining well enough, just ask in the comments. Or email me, dukeofthebump@gmail.com. Or go to dukeofthebump.com for a list of other ways to contact me. And send me a private message on last.fm. If for some reason that's how you want to contact me. Okay, so, oh yeah, I'm not using my shield. I probably should. Alright, crappy bracers. With the shield, my armor class is -4, which is great. So I'm going to say, not to jump the gun or anything, but so far both of these enemies seem pretty manageable. I mean, they're both fairly slow. I haven't really seen what the Naga's capable of, but this thing throws fireballs that I can sidestep without too much difficulty. I have to say, this level's looking good so far. So, I had a pretty good weekend. I had to work on Saturday, but it's not that big of a deal. It was only, I won't bore you with the details, but it was shorter than a normal day. Ah, crap. Look at all these teleporters. I'm gonna get lost in this place. But after I got home on Saturday, I played a pretty good bit of Etrian Odyssey 4. I had a really tough time when I first started playing, because I went somewhere you're not supposed to go. I have a tendency in RPGs to always want to do as many side quests as I can before I continue with the main storyline. And in Etrian Odyssey 4, you actually have the option to go to different labyrinths before the main storyline quest. And I did that, and I got my ass kicked. And then I realized, oh, I guess I'm really not supposed to go here until I do this main storyline quest. Because the first dungeon you go to that the game, you know, expects you to go to has, like, tutorial elements. It actually explains things to you. Come on, step through the teleporter. I don't want to fight you in that cramped little hallway. And it's lying in wait for me. It's pretty smart. I mean, it has 3 brains, so... Man, how come it always... Alright. So, I want to go through the teleporter this way, so I'll be facing the right way, right? Nope, that didn't work. It always throws you... So, every time you go through the teleporter... Well, no, it didn't do it with that teleporter. But... My front is always facing the teleporter, and my back's to the enemy. It's pretty annoying. And with this one, every time I go through it, I'm pointing to the left. Or to the west. Doesn't really matter which direction I approach the teleporter from. That's very odd. Or which way I'm facing, even. Well, I guess I'll have to go toe-to-toe with you, Naga. Because this thing... See? Still facing to the west. That's really weird. Okay. Well, I'm glad the teleporters are starting to become more of a thing, since these dungeon layouts have been relatively straightforward so far. Nowhere to run in this hallway. Oh man, that is a lot of damage. I might be in trouble. Whew. Okay. Let's heal up. Man, Cure Light Wounds barely does anything at this stage. I don't know. That one was pretty good. Alright. So, is there anything to this hallway, or is it just a place? Oh, what's this? A journal page. Well, luckily, I am not using a blade. Oh, someone else pointed out that these scrolls that don't say cleric scroll, I speculated that these might be magic user scrolls and I wouldn't be able to use them. But it seems like they're just all-purpose scrolls that any character can use. So I should be able to use this protection from magic, or this protection from poison, or any other scroll I find that doesn't specify what kind of character it's for. I should be able to use. What an interesting symbol, I wonder what it stands for. Oh, it looks kind of like a compass. But with all the cardinal directions and the secondary directions. I don't know what those are actually called. Oh, someone said that the manual mentioned something about being able to bash through barriers. And they wondered if I could bash through these somehow. And I'm pretty sure I tried it before, and it never worked. So, I'm not really sure what the manual would be referring to there. Maybe there are some barriers later on that you can smash your way through. But I don't think any of the ones I found have that property. So yeah, Etrian Odyssey 4, really liking it so far, despite kind of making it more difficult on myself than it needed to be at the beginning of the game. Even at the wrong, going to the wrong dungeon though, I still managed to kind of slowly make my way through it. And then once I went to the actual right dungeon, I was overpowered for it and I started kicking ass, which felt pretty good. Alright, so what did I... Oh yeah, I wanted to try out these gloves, see if they're better than my gauntlets. Probably not, but it's worth a shot. Nope. Gauntlets are two better. I think usually equipment won't have a magical effect and a boost to your armor class. It's like an either-or proposition, so I'm pretty sure I'm not losing anything by just ditching those gloves. Alright, so where have I not been? Okay, I still have a hallway down here I need to go through. Now to figure out which teleporter leads back here. Shouldn't be that hard to figure out. Oh wait! It's a whole area I haven't gone to yet. Neat. See, that was my aid spell expiring. Nothing I need to worry about. Banded mail. Looks the same as my brigandine, so I will not bother with it. I don't know what, like, the default armor of different armors is. Like, the default armor class. I used to know back when I played second edition a little bit, every now and then. But it's been a while, so like Brigandine wasn't even in the equipment list when I play D&D, so I'm not sure if what I'm getting from it is the base armor class or if there's a magical bonus to it or what. I guess I could cast detect magic on it. I guess in the end, as long as it's giving me the same benefit, it doesn't really matter if it comes from a magical source or not. Oh, it is magical, so not really sure if that means anything. That was a really bad cure serious wounds. So was that. Very underwhelming spell. Alright, what is... Oh yeah, that's a non-magical amulet. I'm just gonna ditch that. That's not gonna do anything. I mean, these bracers are magical, but they're all worse than what I already have, so there's really no point in hanging on to them, I don't think. Just double checking all these. Oh yeah, Ring of Strength. Wait. Did I identify the Ring of Regeneration? Oh yeah, I did. That's right. Never mind. I forgot I had that. Must be very slow regeneration, because I really don't notice that bar going up on its own. Potion of Invisibility, that'll be something I want to hang on to. Potion of Confusion, I need to try throwing that at a monster and see if that does anything. Cloak of Protection plus one? Nah. I'm not going to mess around with that. Wand of Magic Missiles? Okay. So, all the stuff looks like stuff I want to hang on to. Excellent. Okay. Oh wait, there's a hallway up here I didn't go to as well. So. Oh wait, maybe I should get my hammer back, huh? So yeah, that was my, ouch! That was my Saturday, just chilling at home, playing some Etrian Odyssey 4. And then Sunday, hasn't actually happened yet when I record this, but I should be, getting brunch with some pals, and then possibly hanging out and watching movies. I don't know, we haven't really decided the specifics yet. Maybe the Nagas will be dumb enough to come through the teleporter. Yeah, I should probably, cure some critical, huh? Yeah, that was pretty critical. Oh, God. Alright, well, it looks like I'm, oh, man. Looks like I'm getting the heck out of here. Good lord. That was a lot of monsters. Luckily, this Chimera, despite having three brains, decided to follow me, which I appreciate. I'm probably saying that we're completely wrong and people are going to yell at me in the comments. Like when I pronounced, I still don't know how to pronounce Lakitu or Latiku, the Mario enemy that rides the cloud. Still don't know. You'd think I would learn. See, you have to understand. Alright. Whatever's standing in front of me when I walk through this teleporter is getting flame strike. Well, it didn't look like he liked that. I don't know. I can't tell. Alright. I probably don't need negative flame protection anymore because I don't think the Naga counts as undead. So next time I go in to pray for spells, I'll swap it out for something more useful for this level. Uh-oh. Speaking of resting, I should probably think about doing that. Ooh, cleric level 11, nice. I should definitely rest now. All right, level 1. I have one extra spell available. I'm going to get rid of my. Oh wait, let's see, level 3. I got negative plane protection mixed up with invisible to undead. Okay, well I'll hang on to this. I don't really know if my protection from evil is doing me that much good on this level. The Nagas might be considered evil, but I don't think the Chimera is. Okay, that looks good. I have an extra level 3 spell, so I will get rid of negative plane protection. And I can try out Magical Vestment again now that I'm a higher level. Ooh, I should get protection from fire now that I'm dealing with fire-breathing enemies. Good thinking, dude. Good thinking. And I have one more. Well, let's get two protections from fire. Why the heck not? And see if Magical Vestment does me any good. I have an extra level 4. I think just Cure Serious Wounds. Yeah. Stick with what works. And I have a level 6 spell. Nice. Heal. Completely heals you. Removes all status effects. Well, most status effects. Hero's Feast. Completely heals you. Gets rid of some other status effects. But between Heal and Hero's Feast, it takes care of all status effects. So, yeah, level 6 spells. Don't want to fuck around with them. And I have Sol's Searing Orb, which is an attack spell. I probably won't mess around with too much because heal is just too damn useful. Oh yeah, I should probably... Wait, I have rations, right? Yeah, I picked up rations somewhere. I'll be good. Alright. Alright, Clara, heal thyself. Yep, I still have food. Good. Alright. The normal routine. Does that help? No. My armor class still seems to be the same. It's minus 2 without the shield, minus 4 with the shield, right? Yep. So unless magical vestment is an effect that doesn't show up on your stat sheet, then still not worth it at this point in time. Alright, prayer. Protection from fire. Bunch of high level healing spells now. Excellent. Alright, monsters. I'm ready for you. Well, I'm ready for one of you. I'm not ready for four of you at the same time. Or however many there are. Jeez, my knees. It's like a monster jamboree. It's like a discount monster warehouse. I wonder what kind of attack the Naga uses. Alright, let's see how well my protection from fire. Ooh, it only did 3. That's a significant improvement over what it was doing. Okay, these things still hurt, of course, because they're not spitting fire. But I want to get hurt at some point so I can show off the heal spell. Such a good spell. That's a oh shit, I'm gonna die. Survive by the skin of my teeth kind of spell. Alright, is this room finally clear? Okay, good. So I have to say, Etrian Odyssey 4 is quite a different sort of dungeon crawler. It's very weird coming back to this kind of game after playing Etrian Odyssey. Very fast-paced action game. Where you only control one character instead of having to control 5. But you know, with Etrian Odyssey, you can take your time and think all of your turns through. Oh, apparently there are cobwebs here. Alright, so I need to... Okay, so there's some sort of keyhole here. Is it this? Nope. And now I can't... Okay, there it is. Okay, I want the... this does not fit here message. Oh, that was the right key. Wow. I got lucky with that one. It's like pin the tail on the donkey. Pin the horn on the bull. It's pretty much the same thing. And, I mean, there could be items here for all I know, but I'm blind, so I can't see. I could get True Sight, or whatever the spell's called. Now that I have two of these, True Seeing. I could get that instead of Flame Strike. Eh. If I run into a larger dark area where... If I run into a situation where I can't progress because of a dark area, then I'll try out True Seeing. I actually don't know if True Seeing lets you see in the dark areas. It might just be illusionary stuff that's affected by it. Oh god. Alright, those things use magic missiles. I don't have any protection from magic missile spell. So yeah, I like both kinds of games. I like methodical, turn-based, strategy-heavy games. And I like more fast-paced action RPGs like this. I was talking about Legend of Grimrock the other day, and someone commented that the dodging around aspects were what they didn't like about Eye of the Beholder and Legend of Grimrock. And I can see where they're coming from. I really didn't get the dodging aspects of these games the first few times I played them. And I'm not saying he doesn't get it. I'm saying, you know, that mechanic doesn't click with him, which is fine, it didn't click with me, but then, After I figured out how you're actually supposed to play these games, then it all kind of fell into place. Let's create a neater pile so there aren't unnecessary blue dots on the screen. See, the first time I ever played one of these kinds of games was Eye of the Beholder on the Sega CD. And they did a pretty good job of making the controls work with Eye of the Beholder using a Sega Genesis controller. You know, a D-pad, three buttons, and a start button. They did a better job than one might expect, but it's still not an ideal way to play those kinds of games. So once I started playing on the PC, I played kind of the way I was used to playing on a controller, and I didn't realize that there was a better way. Of course, I was super opposed to using a keyboard and mouse at the same time for the longest time when I was a kid. Like, it was the same with Doom, actually, because the first time I played Doom was on the 32X, and then on the computer, well, I guess with Doom you can get by with just using the D-pad, or D-pad, with just using the arrow keys and not bothering with the mouse. But then once Quake came along, and you have an actual full 3D environment, you have to get used to using the mouse to look around. I have no idea where I'm going. Using the mouse to look around and using the keyboard to navigate. And, you know, it's a pretty big hurdle to overcome. People who only like GoldenEye on the N64, I can definitely see why, because I mean, if I didn't make an active effort as a kid to try to get used to that, I might never have. I might have said, screw this, I don't need to use a mouse and keyboard at the same time. If a game makes me use a mouse and keyboard at the same time, then it's not worth playing. You know, I thought that way for the longest time. And then it clicked with me, kind of like how the dodging around and moving quickly. Did I kill that? I was pretty sure that thing teleported away, but maybe I killed it. Oh, okay, this is where I want to be, actually. Okay, great. I'm sure if I wasn't jabbering on and on like I always do, it would have taken me so long to figure out which way to go. I would have actually paid attention to which teleporters go where. But, you know. Playing video games and talking at the same time is it's an acquired skill that, despite having done this for 7 years, I'm not great at it. I mean, I'm okay at it. I'm definitely better at it than I used to be. But there are people who are much more skilled at compartmentalizing than I am. People who can walk and chew gum at the same time, metaphorically. Like, people who work for the radio, like DJs and, you know, people who have radio shows, they have to get used to talking and listening to people at the same time, which I imagine must be really difficult. Because, you know, you're doing your show, you're talking into your microphone, and your producer chimes in your earpiece with information about, you know, the news story you're doing, or, you know, additional, just any information that you might need. And, you know, part of your brain has to process that, but it can't interrupt with the part of your brain that's talking. Or, you know, any other problems that a radio personality might come across. Oh, well, that would have been really helpful 2 floors ago when I was fighting the Grave Mists. So what was I talking about? Oh, yeah, compartmentalizing. The Spelunky streamer, Bananasaurus Rex, is really, really good at that. Like, the way he... I hear something scary that I don't know what it is. But the way he keeps his focus on the game, but still manages to look at the chat room and interact with it, it's kind of amazing. Was that a dragon? That looks like a dragon. Oh, wait, no. That was just part of the Shimura. See? There's that compartmentalizing again. My brain was focused on talking about compartmentalizing. It was very meta. And then I wasn't able to realize that that was part of the same enemy I'd been fighting. I'm expecting a big nasty monster at some point, though, since I'm close enough to hear it. And this is about the level it would start throwing baby dragon. Oh, that sound effect must just be that trap. Just a fireball trap that does not harm me, since I have protection from fire. Well, there's that flower key, and the door that that goes to. I don't actually need to hang on to that. That's not an important door to open, so I'm just gonna drop that. Alright, teleporter, go somewhere good. The water from this tub is cool and refreshing. Really? Seems a little suspicious to me. How would water in this dank abandoned dungeon that's been stagnant for who knows how long, how would that be cool and refreshing? Oops, stepped into the fireball. I guess protection doesn't mean immunity, huh? If it meant immunity, then I'd just go toe-to-toe with the Chimera. My magical vestment spell has expired. Yeah, so can't really tell if that was doing me any good or not. But yeah, Bananasaurus Rex, very, very entertaining streamer if you've never watched his stuff. I know I've talked about his, stand right in front of the fireball trap. I think it's a good time to rest, actually. I wonder if it'll let me rest so close to a trap. Alright, I don't have any more food, do I? No. Well, I could show off Hero's Feast. Oh yeah! There's only one more level of spells. Wow, we're pretty high up there. Alright, actually, before I show off that, I'll show off Heal. Even though I'm about to rest. Bam! 100% hit points. So yeah, I know I've talked about Bananasaurus Rex's eggplant run in Spelunky, which was the first of its kind, and it was really amazing to watch. But he's just an entertaining guy to watch overall. All of his streams are pretty good. Yeah, another Cure Light Wounds, I guess. Did I forget to get this last time? I guess I must have. Alright, Heroes Feast. Nom 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 nom. That was delicious food. Thank you, God. Extreme Communion Wafers. Satisfy your hunger for spirituality. Okay. I should just make a macro that does the stuff automatically. You can do that, right? Make a macro that tells my mouse cursor, or tells my mouse to click in all these areas in a specified order. I'm pretty sure you can do that with auto hotkey. It might be a little weird to set up, since I have to keep the position of the window the same every time. And actually, auto hotkey doesn't seem to work that well with DOSBox anyway. But you know, that wouldn't be the authentic 1993 experience anyway. Ooh, another potion of invisibility. Wow. Unfortunately, since this is the non-glitched kind of invisibility, not the invisibility to undead that I have now, then as soon as I attack, the invisibility will wear off. Oh, that thing shot magic missiles at me. So yeah, the best use case for a potion of invisibility, I think, is if you get surrounded by monsters, because they might... Actually, I don't know if they would stop attacking you and go away, or if they would keep attacking you and just not be able to hit you. I guess either one would be useful, since you know, while it's difficult for them to hit you, you could get a bunch more attacks in and try to clear a path for yourself. Well, no, you couldn't, because as soon as you attack, the invisibility goes away. So it would only be useful in that situation if the monsters not only couldn't hit you, but just ignored you and didn't try to attack you and just moved away. I'm not sure how it works. You know, it's a last-ditch effort kind of thing. If I can't get away and, you know, I don't have any, my wand of teleportation is out of charges, I don't have any hope of getting out of a deadly situation, then try the potion of invisibility and hope for the best. Kind of bummed that my amulet of imminent return ran out of charges. I actually didn't know the amulets could run out of charges. I thought that was just the wand. Oh, there we go. See, kids, it pays to smash your face into walls. Sometimes. Now, a lot of roguelikes have something that can charge your items. Like, I think NetHack has, like, a scroll of charging or something. And I know Pixel Dungeon has it. Oh, God. It has a scroll that just... Any item in your inventory with charges, it'll just charge them up. So any sort of wands or... There are other things in that game that have charges, I think. I don't know, it's been a while. However, I just got a new Android tablet, so I can play Pixel Dungeon some more. It's been a while, they've added a bunch of new stuff to that game. Oh, well, that would be the boss of this level, I assume. 7 points of damage, Alright, I don't have my flame strike anymore, so I'll just have to take this guy out the old-fashioned way. What is that, an Etten? No, wait, the Etten is the two-headed one. This is some sort of giant, or possibly an ogre. Oh, that was that guy. Oh, flesh golem. Okay. Ew. It's a really gross concept. Scale mail. Well, let's try it out. Nope. Oh, and it's cursed. Great. Well, I get to show off the curse removal now. Not that there's really that much to show off. You get remove curse. I'm not using that magical vestment. Let's see. There's something else I wanted to change up, wasn't there? No, I guess not. I'm still good on food. Oh, I should change out the Hero's Feast for heal again. Or Saul's Searing Orb. I could try to do a little damage. I think I'm okay on damage, though. I took that Flesh Golem out pretty easily. Alright, rest. What was that, a level 3? Oh, there we go. Remove curse. And the scale mail is gone. It's still cursed. If I pick it up and put it back on, the curse will be back in effect, and I'll have to cast remove curse again. But yeah, that's all you have to do. Yet another reason you never want to play as any character other than the cleric. Because, I mean, think about it. If you're not a cleric, if you're a fighter, then you're running around picking up all this equipment, and you can't use any of it, because if you risk it on, if you put it on, you risk getting cursed. And I've been pretty lucky with the equipment so far, but you know, who knows? You know, I mean, any random piece of equipment could be cursed. It'll reduce your stats. It'll make you. You know, it'll make you much worse off than you were before, and there's no way to remove it unless you happen to find a scroll of remove curse. Which, you know, good luck. I don't think I found one yet. Ooh, stairs down. Let's go ahead and get the experience and finish fleshing out this map. There's an enemy right there at the steps. So that'll be fun. Alright, actually, is there anything else I need to flesh out here? Well, there's this hallway, I guess. Don't really remember which teleporter leads back there. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm not going to walk around stumbling into teleporters, trying to figure out how to get back there to go down one tiny little hallway. So I think I'm done. Wow, this video's, these are pretty consistently 45 minutes. Most people who expressed an opinion, don't have a problem with the longer videos, so I'm not going to worry about, you know, if a video goes too long. I'm not going to, like, rush through it or anything. I realize that, you know, it can be hard to keep up with a 45 minute to an hour long video 5 days a week, but, you know, hopefully, you know, you can catch up on the weekends, or you can just watch them later on when you have some time. You don't have to watch everything right away. I don't care. So that'll do it. We are on level 9, the halfway mark, everyone. We are getting there. This is, well, I guess technically the halfway mark won't be until after we finish level 9. But still, pretty good progress. I'm feeling good. Feeling really good. Tune in tomorrow for level 9. Bye, everyone.